Well, good evening and welcome to the 2016-2017 Poetry at the Dalí Festival series. I'm really glad to see you, those of you stalwarts who have come out tonight. It's always hard to get engaged in the first of a series, and we've started up the engines from a very wonderful last year that Helen led, and we're looking forward to a really terrific program, very dense, every month with the exception of the Grand Prix month. I could have used the term March, but I do like to kind of put the onus on the Grand Prix for interrupting the poetic spirit in our area. That said, we embrace arts, culture, and commerce of all kinds. So this program is unique, and I'm very proud of it here at the Dalí because we have Helen Wallace, the Poet Laureate of St. Petersburg. I first heard Helen's poetry read by a minister in church, a poem about 9/11, and it's the most wrenching poem about 9/11 you may have ever heard. So at some day she'll treat us with that, but not today, because Helen and I were talking about the theme for the year, and we set, because right now we're preparing a show to open next week after next about food by Ferran Adrià. Now, Ferran Adrià is the chef par excellence, the Dalinian chef. He's a deconstructive chef who invented molecular gastronomy. His restaurant was voted the best in the world for 5 years. He's an absolute genius, and his restaurant, Rosas, was about this far from Dali's home. If you look at a map, they're congruous, the two places. So there's something about the spirit of that place to reassess who we are and how we do things. And so we having this food show, we decided that sustenance might be a theme that our poets could address, even if they didn't have to write them differently, you know. We do try to sustain ourselves with language, with emotion, with hope, etc. The other thing I'm proud about, which is next to Helen being Poet Laureate of St. Petersburg, is that I asked Helen to curate and administer this program before she became Poet Laureate. So I think that almost is kind of like a foresight. Helen's first collection of poems was called Shimming the Glass House and was chosen for the 2007 Richard Snyder Prize. She's published poems in the Literary Review, the Midwest Quarterly, the Cumberland Review, Nimrod International, Tampa Review, and she served as co-editor of the anthology Isle of Flowers. Now that might have something to do with La Isla Florida, Florida, I think, which affects all of us. She's received the McKay Shaw Academy of American Poets Award, and she's been a resident fellow at the Virginia Center for the Creative Arts. Also a recipient of the Tennessee Williams Scholarship from the Solanis Writers Conference. And she received her PhD from the University of Florida. That's probably the most dangerous far more delicate than gators. Did I say gators? I'm sorry. It's dangerous territory. And she has for years been teaching at Eckerd College, their poetry writing program. So we're one of the stipulations that I ask Helen to agree to as we design this program is that she would begin the evenings with a reading of her own poems. And her discussion. And so she's going to do that tonight, and she will introduce tonight's writers, whom we're really thrilled are here with us tonight. So thank you.
Thank you all for coming out this evening. It's so good to see some familiar faces, people who have come back from our season, last year. And, we run through the spring and then we take a break for the summer and then pick back up in September. So I really appreciate seeing you guys back again. And we will be meeting the second Thursday of every month from 6 to 7:30, except for us, as Hank said, except for March. And we have a great lineup. Still in formation, but we have some terrific people coming, including Erica Dawson and Rita Martinez starting us out tonight. We have folks like Jay Hoffler, Holly Iglesias, Campbell McGrath, Jane Hirschfield, and possibly Todd Boss. Many good people. And we'd love to see all of you back as many times as you can come. I want to say thank you first to the museum, especially to Hank, for being a big part of this program. You know, Hank is a poet himself, and I'm working on trying to get him to actually be part of our program, possibly if we are able to get Todd Boss here. He certainly is a poet that we all need to hear as well. But lots of people to thank. John, Bat and Evie, thank you, John. Kathy and Sarah and Peter, thanks to all of you for helping us put this program together. Okay, I'm going to read just one short poem. And I don't think this poem needs too much introduction, except this. This is big news. And maybe you already know it, but we have a terrific exhibit on Frida Kahlo's work coming in December. So that should be fabulous. And the combination of that, plus the theme that Hank mentioned about food and sustenance. By the way, I tell all of our poets to please feel free to interpret that as broadly as you wish. We don't want to tie your hands in any way. And certainly you are welcome to read some poems that don't necessarily deal with that. But we try to find broad themes, so just about everything it seems might be somehow related to some kind of sustenance. So this is a poem that is about Frida Kahlo and her very tumultuous relationship with her husband, Diego Rivera. And I think you all probably know plenty about that. You know, they were married two different times. And you know from her work, all of her lush imagery and the flowers and the fruits and anyway, you'll see or hear all of this, I hope, in this poem. Still life with Diego. Their lives set always to boil. She roasted the chilies till blisters appeared on their skins, cut off the tops, then scraped out their seeds, their ribs. The table in Casa Azul cascaded with platters arranged like a still life midday, but nothing was still. Whole of pomegranates boiled in glistening seeds, a melon split open to flesh of wounds or sex, swallowed by flowers, stamen piercing the plates. Anthuriums bowed their heads. She lured her pets to the table, parrots perched on chairs, her monkey Fulang hugging her elegant neck. Everywhere that fragrance, poblanos stuffed with more than pork and onions, sesame, a dense brick of chocolate. With mole oaxaqueño, she practiced adjusting the heat. Rita loves all things Jane Eyre. Her poetry collection, The Jane and Bertha in Me, which was published in 2016 by Alter Press, celebrates Charlotte Bronte's classic novel and the bicentenary of the author's birth. Her poetry also appears in the textbook Three Genres, the writing of fiction, literary nonfiction, poetry, and drama, and in the anthology Burnt Sugar, Kanda Kimala, contemporary Cuban poetry in English and Spanish. Martinez has been a featured author for the Miami Book Fair, the Orange Island Arts Foundation, and the Palabra Para, reading series in Chicago. She's a guest contributor for the Poets and Artists blog and a writing consultant for Novo Southeastern University. She lives in Miami, Florida, and I also want to welcome her husband, Todd. Mm-hmm. Please welcome.
This first poem I'm going to read is about my father. He has a real big green thumb. He has a lot of banana trees and a lot of mango trees. He doesn't really eat the fruit he grows that much. It's more like he likes to give it to people, but there's something, I guess, about it makes him feel, I guess, like a creator, that he's growing things in the yard. So this poem is called Going Bananas. My father rises each morning to the 17 varieties of banana trees he's cultivated with unrivaled care, each tree casting shade across our lawn, each racimo an offering. My father hacks with his machete, a small cruelty he performs like a doctor circumcising a newborn. Though I like to think he is unburdening these trees, casting weight off the tired trunks of his aromatic, his enduring Goldfinger and its hybrids, Fia 3 and Fia 18, his 22-foot tall Saba, tallest banana tree in the world, his Mona Lisa, lady's finger, ice cream, banana, his apple sugar, AKA Manzano, his Plátano Enano, dwarf Cavendish, sweet midget sacrificed to the blender for smoothies, his Jamaican red, his Cuban red, his Misiluki, his Mysore, his 3640, his Gran Lain, and my favorite, Orinoco. Plátano burro he hauls into the house with the pride of a hunter. When he enters the kitchen wearing his sweat-stained Going Bananas t-shirt, my mother stares at the shoot dangling from his hands like a third arm and smiles, though I know she's thinking of resin that'll cling to the cutting board and her fingers. But he submits those plátanos like a boy bringing a drawing to be exhibited on the refrigerator door. So she strips, slices, mashes, fries until they're crunchy, sweet, and salted tostones, mini sunflowers, humbly acquiescing beside the breaded steak on my father's ivory dinner plate. So I first read Jane Eyre when I was in high school. This poem is about how the obsession started. All right. And it's kind of, I'm very happy to be here surrounded by so many, to be surrounded by lovers of poetry, it's a nice feeling. And I'm especially happy to be here because, like Helen said, this year marks the bicentennial of Charlotte Bronte's birth. Okay. So this first poem is called Reading Jane Eyre. I covered it with clear contact paper, wrote my name in caps across the forehead in black marker. The book rested on my desk like a rainbow trout. Mrs. Lloyd poised on the stool, her bangs and bob, stiff like a man in a toupee, face primed with a thick coat of concealer. She hinted a secret at the heart of the text. I spotted it in her eyes whenever she laughed, flung her arms like tentacles, crossed her legs, private insanity hidden inside her wisteria wool skirt, tucked out of sight like like Thornfield's third floor tenant, Linda Blair's precursor, the basket case languishing in bed. I read in bed on the bamboo love seat beneath the shade of my father's banana trees. I scarfed the pages like pork rinds, yuca chips, crackers slathered with guava jelly. I binged constantly, sunk my canines into text while Blur's Boys and Girls wailed in the background like Bertha on speed. I carried it for weeks inside the outer pocket of my East Pack like Tic Tacs, a compact I'd flip open during lunch between classes before soccer practice. Bantam paperback lodged between Agnes Gray and Wuthering Heights at Adolph's bookstore. It's fine, red-orange like papaya pulp. I plucked it from the shelf and stared at the cover. The forlorn wedding dress yearning for Jane's scapula, her small breasts, the warmth of her hips when she walks across the bedroom and steps into wedding slippers, then into absence. The foots descend, consuming as quicksand, the subtle curve of her arch, sheathed by glass. So growing up, sometimes on Sundays, I used to watch those old Tarzan movies, those old black and white, most of them. Tarzan movies, my favorite ones were always the ones with the actor Johnny Weissmuller. Okay. So this poem is sort of relates a little bit to some of those movies a little bit, but actually this poem is called Jane Eyre Thinks of Tarzan's Jane at Canton's. And then I included a quote, which is by Jane Rees, who's the author of Why Sargasso Sea. It's a novel that is considered a prequel to Jane Eyre. And the quote says, the quote is about Edward Rochester. And he's the Jane Eyre's love interest. Jane Eyre is she's a governess. And he's the master of the house and her love interest. The quote says, his stay in the West Indies has changed him out of all knowledge. He has gray in his hair and misery in his eyes. Okay. Jane Eyre thinks of Tarzan's Jane at Canton's. We eat here because it is quick, cheap, and delicious. Underneath the table, your fingers touch the almost nakedness of my sandaled feet. Fried noodles in a bamboo bowl resemble chopped vines. Remind me of Sunday afternoons squandered watching old Tarzan flicks while munching on noodles from takeout. Johnny Weissmuller swung fearlessly from vines, bare feet dangling in mid-flight, then traipsing through dirt and mud. Johnny once chased women on the studio lot, sans loincloth. I think of loincloths and love in the treehouse, of Tarzan caressing the soles of Jane's feet the way you caress mine, of Jane wrapping the vines of her legs around the ape man's waist in the jungle night as he buries his face in her curly hair, strong as vines and dark as night, as mine, which you tug and often envision billowing underwater. Though I know you're not immersed in the jungle, recreating scenes from Tarzan and his mate, the jungle, that green menace, too much like Jamaica, dusty, reminiscent of sunburns, of feverish nights, spent squatting mosquitoes that boldly alighted on your neck. No treehouse for you, nix the vines, ditto on the refined Merino Sullivan. I've usually lost you to a concrete jungle, to Splash and Daryl Hannah when you part my drenched hair and fan each half over a neighboring breast.
Thank you.
to be about Bertha, and it's called Cause and Effect. Because Bertha's left hip is higher than the right, she measures the pool water's pH every day. Because her right breast is larger than the left, she's skeptical of new and improved laundry detergent, of buy one, get one free advertisements. She puckers, she contours, she slathers her kisser with Pink Panther lipstick before slipping under plaid quilts, because there's a macaroni-shaped scar on her lip. And because her lips continue to move after she finishes speaking, she reads the Bible, wears red flannel, says she's the first female to speak a silent tongue. The mystery in her life centers on why she pours ketchup across the periphery of her burger before every bite. Why she refuses to eat scrambled eggs unless she sprinkles a dash of salt for each of pepper. And because her left eye twitches when she eats, she pitches her fork into a piece of chocolate cream pie and pops it in her mouth for the cast of Unsolved Mysteries, for the National Enquirer, for the Guinness Book of World Records. So I think I'm also going to read one called Reading Jane Slayer. It's a mashup novel by an author named Sherry Irwin. You may have heard of, I haven't read it, but you may have heard of like Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, right? And then I know they made like a movie called Abraham Lincoln Vampire Killer. So I haven't seen those. But obviously, obsessed with Jane Eyre, obviously I was going to read Jane Slayer. So basically she uses, Sherry Irwin takes the novel and she sort of adds like a twist to it. Jane kind of becomes similar to, if any of you ever saw that TV series Buffy, where you have like a teenage vampire hunter as a protagonist. That's more or less what she does to Jane Eyre. And then I included a quote before the poem from this novel, and it says, "Reader, I buried him." Reading Jane Slayer. After reading Jane Eyre, I fell in love with Jane Slayer, the tiny female Van Helsing-like avenger who eradicates unruly members of the undead, a vocation confirmed when John Reed tries to gobble a destitute orphan like a Little Debbie snack cake. I admire Jane's ingenuity and foresight. Hours employed gathering and sharpening wood, stakes always up her sleeve or stowed beneath her skirt in case VSP, vampiric sensory perception, kicks in. I admire the quick draw, nimble fingers unsheathing Egyptian daggers, a beloved keepsake from this temple for severing zombie heads despite the inevitable aftermath of green goo that will coat Jane's pinafore and stockings like nuclear waste. Reader, I found myself rooting for a literary smackdown between the blood-sucking Blanche and the jaguarish Jane. I wanted what countless women have wanted, to cheer and do the wave as Jane drives a stake through her rival's shriveled heart. Miss Ingram, the unrepentant socialite, guilty of precipitating her own demise, of prematurely turning into a pile of dust at Jane's feet, the penalty exacted for chomping a little Adele's thighs like a pair of KFC drumsticks. In the novel Blanche Ingram, she's the girl you kind of love to hate. She's sort of like, if she was cast in the movie Mean Girls, she would be like the leader of the Mean Girls. So I think I'm going to read just one more. Okay. I'm going to read a poem called At the British Library. So it's kind of about that experience if you've ever been, let's say, you're visiting some sort of museum or library, and sometimes, like, without, you don't realize maybe all of their holdings, and you sort of run into something that is kind of amazing. So it's sort of about that. At the British Library, Charlotte's manuscript sepulchered like an incorruptible saint, splayed on its back like a woman whose architecture I want to touch, to trace the arc of her earlobes, taste her delicate torso, swallow the goodness spilling from both breasts, from the crevice between her legs, ingest her jutting shoulder blades, drench myself with her rhapsodic scent, trap her long hand beneath the drawbridge of my tongue. Thank you. Thank you so much, Rita. I think many of you here in the room might have been here last year when Denise Duhamel read. She's the one who suggested that we get in touch with Rita, who was, you were her former student in Miami. So yeah, it's such a
Campbell
treat.
And
Campbell
yeah,
also, good.
You said he'll be reading.
Yes,
yeah
I think in February, yeah. Mm-hmm. So terrific, thank you so much. Your reference to the wave made me realize we need to welcome our state poet laureate, Peter Mikey, and his wife Jeannie. Small Blades Hurt, winner of the 2016 Poets Prize and a 2014 Florida Book Awards Bronze Medal in Poetry. And also Big Eyed Afraid, winner of the 2006 Anthony Hecht Award. Her work has appeared in 3 editions of Best American Poetry, Barrow Street, Harvard Review, Literary Imagination, the Virginia Quarterly Review, and numerous other anthologies and journals. An associate professor of English and writing, she is the director of the University of Tampa's Low Residency MFA in Creative Writing Program. Please welcome. Please welcome Erica.
Thank you, Helen, so much for inviting me to be part of this and for dealing with the times that I had to say no, unfortunately, last year. Because of travel and things like that, so I'm really happy to be here. Thank you. And thanks to everyone at the Dalí Museum for making all of this possible. And to you for coming out on a Thursday night at 6 o'clock. It's a weird time. And I have to give a special shout out, since Mona already woohooed, to my UT people in the audience, my former student Kara and Mona, and Amanda, a current student in our MFA program, and my colleagues, Daniel and Leslie. So thanks for coming across the bridge. And thank you, Rita, for that beautiful reading, and also for mentioning Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter, which I thought was amazing, but just keep in mind that I watched that movie in the middle of the night. I'm a chronic insomniac, so my wits were not about me, but, you know, why not? So when I got the email from Rita, from Helen, he said the theme was food and sustenance. I didn't really know what to do. So I can't read this event anymore. But I was talking to Rita about this before the reading. I had more sort of references to food than I actually thought that I did. But my mind sort of played from there, and I became more interested in the idea of sustenance. And that idea of sustenance is something that provides us with nourishment and strength, and something that helps us maintain our existence, the stuff that helps us survive. So you'll hear a lot more about relationships and travel and other things, the future and the past, more so than food. But I tried. So. And bear with me, this is the first time ever that I'm going to actually read publicly in my reading glasses, because I can no longer see. So if I throw them on the, the doctor was like, please stop not wearing these glasses. So if I throw them on the floor in frustration, that's why. Credo. As a woman, I have learned some men are really bad at whispering. As if their tenors can be tampered. Slight winds, perhaps, more apt at fine seduction. Still, give me their manly lows, their broader pitch of O's, pharynx, tremors, and hard G's. Now I've come to think their throats are coated red, a bright red, engorged, a sinew of veins across their necks, when they inflect a sound and swallow, always understood. Though something should be said for breath, an H unseen in God, lit and come here, my mouth is big. I think I'm ready for my manhood. Part of survival is getting out of town every now and then. When I lived in Cincinnati, I got the chance to go on an artist retreat in Archer City, Texas, which is where Larry McMurtry lives, novelist, author of Terms of Endearment, The Last Picture Show. I actually got to watch the film The Last Picture Show in the actual Last Picture Show building where the movie was filmed. It was all meta. So I wrote a poem about that trip. It's called Layover. I've half a mind to make a move, because I stayed in Archer City, where I made Larry McMurtry proud by downing one too many shots of ice-cold vodka, tumbler-sized. I hollered every word of Sweet Home Alabama, while the band reprised Knockin' on Heaven's Door, and packed up and quit the Legion dance. I thought I didn't know that song. I two-stepped with a cowboy, kissed a Yankee wrong, and regretted it. So found my cowboy once again. The Yankee looking like a young Paul Newman, but the cowboy, like, I'll bet you, hard and hot in jeans. What was it in the Texas air that brought Delilah out of me? Was it the quail and wild hogs, or the barbecue cooked from a cow that tasted like a slaughtered cow? What hiked my temperature? It climbed the diving board and took its clothes off piece by piece, as if last May were my last picture show. A last chance to sweat with strangers in a spur hotel room, so quaint with double beds and Lord Byron on the table. Me, a Sybil Shepherd in the lights for the first time, marking the stage, walking in beauty like the night, too much for such a little place, where the town Indian said she was the town Indian. And my sweet cowboy said I gave him eyes, said I was high-heeled trouble, said I have the tendency to lead. have to clap after every poem, but I'm going to let you. It's making me feel special. So when I lived in Cincinnati and Columbus, Ohio, before that, when I was in graduate school, you know, you're forced to live in that Midwestern gray sky. It's just opaque all the time, and you feel like you're dying. It's true. You feel like you're dying, and everything is already dead and sort of covered with the sheen of ice. And in Columbus, the only thing that sort of kept me going through those winter months was the sound of the train going behind my house. The tracks were right behind my house. So I wrote this poem in those moments. It's called Parallax. Icicles plummet from the porch, and so drips, prisms, rainbows, dagger celestial in their own right. They're lit with touch and go low beams. The moon slices residual storm clouds. Kaleidoscopes, the crystals crack colorless on the concrete and land in black. And you stare that black more black, until three branches across the street from a broken tree lose edge, shape, and still the vantage, the last before you sleep. Through hedges, you can see the train is coming slow and coming fast. The later it gets, the more the sky will glow in a strange reversal. Immaterial, the stars are hidden in the indigo turning to rose. A pink so prophetical of sunny days, our nightly almanac. And on the quarry lake, the mallards crack. Drakes lift and soar as if they're willowy feathers. A squawking goose attempts to free their noise. He flaps his wings in the water's brass of droplets rising from the ice debris. The train is coming slow and coming fast. The more you sleep, the harder it is to throw the nightmare off yourself with its optical illusion and your eyes closed. Then, with no vision, your everywhere is visual. I had a soundless dream once, saw the smack of cedar switches, saw the sting on black lip bodies like spring blooms hang delicately from a bough like strange fruit, a decaying canopy of shade. I picked each one. One laughed at me. The body mouthed, blue-lipped, will fall eventually. The train is coming slow. And coming fast, the wind-blown icicles and jagged snow knock at my door. Alive, no, their visceral is scraping fingernails. And the curio skyline moves like a shaken snow globe full of glittered flakes inside their hands. They say, we're back. Now let us in. The taps won't stop, so I pack my ears with tissue. Yeah, those drapes could be your noose, they say, your history. Yes, you go free, but no, sputter and snap. Look on aghast. Go on and gag on your own gravity, because the train is coming slow and coming fast. Such parallax. The seesawing winks, the grow, the shrink of land, the awesome, always temporal, and all the voices mine. I see the train track show straight as a V, the lights bearing destinal, an oversight on dirt and a growing stack of branches. It seems they'll never shine in the ice where track meets street and the land spreads constantly flat as a free expanse of time and space. Consistently, the horn blows louder, the sound clearer. The breezes gas with fumes when the red eyes start to flash. Fuck me, because the train is coming. It's slow and coming. Fast as swing low, the arm comes down. Protection, illusory. The scene melding quick as prose and poetry. And I take it all in, still, as a metaphrast. So Pied Piper, play that piccolo. Just tell me, the train is coming slow. And coming fast. So I had this really stupid idea one night after I watched Abraham Vampire. But I decided decided that I wanted for my next project to write a book-length poem. I won't decide to do that again. But in sort of keeping with the theme of sustenance, I am really interested in beginnings and endings in this new project, and that means that I have to go way back to the beginning in the Bible, and as current as the political climate that we find ourselves in. So I thought I'd read you a little bit from the beginning of the manuscript, some of the biblical stuff. So the poem itself is called When Raps Spoke Straight to God, and there's an epigraph by Wendell Berry, Practice Resurrection. In the beginning tried, but it couldn't gag a woman's gospel. So Mary said with swag, I deserve a steed for this. This ride, the sex that didn't need bodies. No straining hip craned nearly out of socket. Not one flex, there was no seduction. But there's a way to lick your lip without moving your tongue. You have to get down on your knees and your hands will get dirty. The rain on April grass is warm. Just let it kiss you. I am only half of 30, but my body had its way with me, much less violent than you would think. It was a kind of shame. Was there a change? Was I branded a new woman? Was I even a woman yet? Though I chew the hot resin of myrrh now, still my stress sits on my chest, and somehow I look the same. In the beginning had the inflection, a register, and Joseph flexin' telling the story when Mary tells me, Joseph, it's a son by someone you can't see. I say, Mary, believe this. My throat itches this. This someone Doug did told you wrong. This which cannot conceive omnipotence. Since, clearly, it can't see me taking down box trees with just an eye axe. Because these here, these are my hands. That there is a freestanding wood carving of a scene I made where I come in my hand and Mary walks in when I finish, thinking I do know a man, and he too is God's favor. I made a steer and a hen, a copy of her hand. I know there is no mark that can carve noises out of her, but there's magnitude within a given, and then there's magnitude. If the spirit somehow finds its voice, there will be no apologies. Just sustenance and scythe and sow. This is me, disillusioned with the mouth. This is me, thinking of the time I came as fire in an apostle's throat. This is me as the burn that a believer breathes. This is me sucking on small stacks of dimes tucked into either side of my frenulum. This is my fissured tongue as wishing well. I deserve no need for this hunger. I call the space between my lips my hunt for satisfaction. Persistent, but a dead woman is rigor. More moonlight and branch than moonlight on a branch. I want to cut my teeth on her. Her skin holds dawn's illusion. Postmortem piss dries yellow on her thigh. I don't know why she dies or who she is. Whether I murdered her in quiet sleep because I myself can't dream dying, or simply because I'm literary and survive on metaphors. I do know moons are just a phase away from their returns, and she is always there. I've missed her more than enough to touch her in what once was due. I hear her in rain that spits like an ever-circling scavenger. Night wears her now on its forehead and spots only a mother's smells. And there, in her rigor, she smells of thunderstorms distilled in mulch. Perfumed with petals closing moon-white plumes to suckle honey, she smells of star anise and lime zest. I sense her freesia in a zephyr's crook. And how I envy her night blue artery, looking hawkish enough to crack at night like hoarfrost. And I wrote this one for my hometown of Baltimore. It's called Gave Proof. Before the ravens came, we knew of grief already. We had Orioles. We had the Bromo Seltzer's light in every face illuminating blue for 20 miles. We had December 1917 and Jim Crow and the visitors rapping at the front door. The Baltimore PD in black on white McCullough Street, where black Mr. William T. Coleman was not to lay his hat. We had Crow, we had gloating lamplight, we had the gallant gleam baptizing the constellation. We had one soliloquy of we the people, we hold these, we therefore, we've been wanting, and we know how to eat crab with Old Bay, since that's what makes it good. We craved Calliope whistles stationed in B&O hissed steam. We knew the next cicada year would turn our nearby Sandy Point Plutonian as last time. We knew snakehead fish would walk. So when the ravens came, Memorial was nothing, not a single wire. And all the demons dreamed with open eyes so dark they were purple. We knew that every city's heart's four chambers took the city's humid air and grew denser and perfumed and salt thick and unseen. Whoever it was out there who was like, oh yeah, when I said Old Bay, thank you for that. I don't know who you were, but you know who you are. This is the final poem warning, but it's a fake out warning because it's a crown of sonnets. So there are seven poems in one. So go ahead and stretch it out and get comfy again. I'm always interested in memory and how we let some memories survive, the things that we think about every day, and others just sort of vanish into the ether, things we don't want to remember. In the way then that you and your brother, you and your parents, or your spouse, or whatever, have memories of the same event, but you remember it in different ways. You actually lived a different experience. And I'm just always interested in those ideas. And so I was thinking about that when I wrote this poem, which is called Bees in the Attic. And it's a true story. When I was, I don't know, like 4 or 5, I guess, there was this noise coming from the ceiling in my bedroom. This really bizarre noise, but it was constantly there. And my mom would tell you that she heard the noise first, and that I didn't hear it at all. And then my dad would say that he heard the noise first, which is not true. I heard it first. And once they acknowledged that there was an actual noise, they went up into the attic and then called the exterminator, who took roughly 4 to 5 lawn and leaf bags full of bees and hives out of the house. It's the title, Bees in the Attic. And I stole a little bit from my Lord and Savior William Shakespeare as an epigraph. When to the sweet sessions of silent thoughts, I summon up remembrance of things past. As if I'd move enough to make a noise as loud as theirs, those bees, I circled around my whirring bedroom, hurdling children's toys. I thought my lungs would buzz the attic's sound, crescendo, shh, and hum. Went round until I lost my breath and lay down. The ceiling wet, white dark with the hive. I dreamt the comb would spill its honey on my pink blankets. When it met my lips, the plaster lathe would crack, and sweet dead bees stuck to the stucco shards would swarm my face. I drown in wings and the petite menagerie with the giant verve. So, warm and wrapped, I moved the covers, stood on my toes and reached, and to this day, nobody knows I reached. And to this day, nobody knows the stucco's crimson dot came from my tongue. When helping mom in our small kitchen, I flung the spinach water and the afterflows of faucet drips with my flicking fingers, throws to the fogged window above the sink. They always clung, and I waited for seconds until the window rung itself of green steam tears and the glass sang the woes of hissing chicken thighs fried in the cast iron pot. And the window sang in grandma's voice, sang, "Go down, Moses." And the stained glass sugar plum fairy that hung on the liquid pane, at the last my people go, raised up her hands in rejoice. I heard the bees from there growl in a hum. From there, I heard the bees growl in a hum everywhere, in sylvan lilacs that I picked from the basement's dollhouse, singing in the drumming dryer's pulse as the washer flowed and clicked. Their noise was huge to my pint-sized figurines who had no ears but eye-shaped mouths. I posed the dolls and their arms and legs in small domestic scenes of Daddy's home. Their tiny red door closed, their eye mouths always open in a gasp or scream, as if something were about to fall upon their house like the locust plague. The hasp was fastened tight. I knocked them down, played all four die before the darkness could descend, as if somehow I'd write their perfect end. As if somehow I'd write the perfect end to every moment, tonight outside my house long left behind, I watch a hydrant douse a child. And when I let the darkness bend around me in a blink, I fade to black. Eyes closed, I eulogize the harbor's dock, the old bay, the lit up Bromo Seltzer clock, blue in the smoke from the beacon, the factory stack, nights quasi black against the smoke's bright white. The voice inside my head is always talking smack. Like the coda of today is just tonight. There's no climax, only here in your bric-a-brac of memories, just fond in retrospect. In them, the spring azaleas genuflect. In them, the spring azaleas genuflect, wilting, about to die in our little garden. The noon sun bores too hot, and sweat droplets harden, casing my cheeks as new weeds bottleneck the ants in their sidewalk cracks. One spring, I cried and checked in mania. I died my hardest, but it never took. No doubt I didn't have the guts to try, though I'd scout locations, the tool shed, the shower, tub, and Dad and Mom in separate rooms would sleep right through my tiptoe wandering about our blue big signing house. So I settled on the plaid of my own sheets beneath that ceiling, penning the letter in my head. It pounded with adrenaline. It pounds still in my head with my adrenaline. Dear Mom, call me the dummy, the mannequin, dead as the dancer in the box that sings the Mendelssohn on the top shelf and rings with the scope of bells and vibrates with the sound of clocks. The clock ticks loud as fall rewound at every equinox again and again. So when you think of me, remember when I last said sorry. As the autumns pass at 4:45, the time goes fast and the grass will slow its growth. But I am huge in your head, pounding, and we're the same. Your blood, I've bled. You're sleeping in my bed now, in the sound of bees. I'm swimming in the hollow sound of seas. But now I'm still swimming in that sound of seas, the inexhaustible murmur. Now I'm back to letters, at my desk of letters and keys, a paper and screen, an egomaniac, dear critics. A narcissist tried art inside a paper's looking glass, distorted, wide with me in my burnt hair, the blistered ember from the core of a stove's hot comb. And I remember my silence sweet as canopy beds or a girl in spinning Duchess Satin's whispered world. Because then, all the days ahead were bees in the attic. The moment still unseen, but heard, ecstatic, promising blood as I stood and now stand all poised, as if I'll move enough to make a noise. Thank you.
Seven sonnets, and the last line of the first sonnet becomes the first line of the next. So, and then the last line of the second sonnet becomes the first line of the third. And so by the time you loop all the way around, the very first line of the poem is the last line of
the
poem.
That's
a killing. Yeah, I again, it was a bad decision made in the middle of the night, but they're actually really fun to write. I highly recommend it.
Hi, it's Brooks. The word metaphrast was in one of your poems. Was that in the epigraph, or was that a word that you was in your poem?
It was in the poem.
I thought it was fascinating.
Thank you. I'm a dictionary junkie. Actually, like read the dictionary like people read novels. And I just stumbled into that word and the idea of sort of the way that genres and forms of art come together, and it rhymed with fast. So I got it.
And that must be one of the reasons you blow me away.
Oh. Thank you.
You stun me.
Thank you so much.
All I know to say.
Thank you. Don't make me cry on the stage and the video and everything.
It's okay, you made me cry.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
And where can I get your work?
I don't have copies of the books with me tonight. I'm sorry about. I know, right? Sarah's like, what? But you can find them on Amazon or any other online bookseller.
We will have copies out front. Rita's after we are sorry we don't have yours on this time, but yeah, look online at Amazon and find her. Other questions, please.
I've got questions.
I feel bad for your parents. It's really pricey to get rid of bees.
Because
we had
we
had some and it wasn't that bad. Yeah. They have to, it's very detailed. You can't just get rid of the hive because they'll come back. So and
it was sort of
you
a
have
ridiculous
to,
process.
Yeah, hire special people. It's like very involved.
Yeah. I had to sleep in the basement for a while. I wanted my brother to sleep in the basement, but I had to. But yeah, it was sort of an intense moment.
I have a question for you, Rita. I'm wondering, when you are in the mind of Jane Eyre, how would you say it's different in terms of the writing process? Is there a difference when you're in Jane's mind and writing a sort of poem with Jane versus when you're writing a poem in Bertha's mind? Can you talk a little bit about your process and if it's any different, given the differences in those two characters?
Okay, let me take a look at the titles of the poems. Okay. So there are some poems that are about Bertha, but that are like third person. Like there's one about Bertha being on the metro. right? Yeah. And then kind of the narrator in the poem visits a friend who's like in a mental institution, because in the novel, Bertha's a character that suffers from insanity. Kind of this idea that at certain points, maybe we're all just one step away from, you know, not things that aren't so good. But sort of kind of viewing the world through that lens. There's a poem also called The Mad Woman that is all about her. It's an abecedarian, which is like a different, you know, a form that it starts the first letter with A, you know, every line starts with the next letter of the alphabet. And that one, it is really all about Bertha. That one's really different from a lot of the poems in the book in that it's really out there. It'll talk about the medical professions, things that happen, things that went on, injustices that used to happen. Because in the book, an issue is that Rochester has his wife, Bertha, locked away, right? And he gets a lot of criticism for that. And a lot of it is justified. But at the same time, what was the alternative? If she was in an insane asylum back then, she probably would have been chained to a bed and living in her own filth. So it just kind of brings up all these ideas and stereotypes. It mentions a lot of stereotypes, but in an effort to sort of break away from that. It's fun to write poems as both Jane and Bertha. And I think with Bertha, you can write some poems that are sort of kookier. Yeah, or do more unexpected things, like the poem that I read, the cause and effect poem, where she does like all these kind of quirky things. And maybe it reminds someone in the audience, we all have a friend that we could probably think of in a second that maybe has like some quirks, right? Some quirks about them. But there's this idea that Gilbert and Gubar set forth their writers and their feminist theorists. They wrote like a really famous book called The Mad Woman in the Attic. And they're like one of the first or the first that proposed this idea that Bertha is Jane's doppelganger. Doppelganger, right?
Yeah.
All right. So it's sort of like when I read a poem about Jane, it's also about Bertha. But it's a lot more liberating. I like persona poems because I guess just from being a kid, I loved Halloween and pretending to be someone else, right? I feel freer. A lot of that, don't you feel freer sometimes in persona poems? You can say and do things and say, well, it's not me. That's that's the character. So it's a lot of fun.
Sure.
Erica.
Yes, Mona.
This book-length poem. So two questions. How did you come up with the subject, the idea, the concept of what it's going to be about? Mm-hmm. And what do you do to not stray off into the nether zone while you're writing it and stay on task with the subject?
I sort of started writing it and the idea came second. I found myself just sort of ruminating on those beginning chapters of the Bible. I don't know why, like I don't go to church, I don't know where that came from, but it started happening. Like I wrote about Mary and Joseph and then Moses got involved and then Job came out of nowhere. And then I was like, you're doing something here. Like there's something that's interesting you. And I thought that it would be kind of fun to sort of follow the narrative of the Bible while also following the narrative of what's happening in our world right now. And I decided that it seemed like that would work best as a single poem rather than, you know, sort of things that are separated by page breaks. So it sort of evolved after I realized that that's what I was doing and I realized that I should do it, if that makes sense. But I let myself deviate from it. If I try to confine myself to, you know, I'm at point C and I need to get to G and I know how to get there, then I just start to shut down. So I let my brain just kind of go wherever I want. And if wherever I want doesn't fit in with the, you know, project, then I'll just save it for something else. But if I sort of force myself, I think, in the way that novelists must have to, it's like, this is my character, this is my story, I gotta get from, I would give up. I can't work that way. So I let myself play around. And that's where the fun stuff has happened so far.
And are you reading in different forms throughout
mm-hmm.
the book?
Because I can't function without the forms. the first two parts that I read with Mary and Joseph, those are both sonnets. But as the manuscript goes on, I change subjects and speakers even in the middle of like a sestina or a villanelle. So that's the thing that keeps me going. It's like, I don't really know where I'm going, but if there's a sonnet, then I know that the third line has to rhyme with the first. So it that's sort of what keeps me grounded.
What is the title of that poem?
The book-length poem that I'm working on, When Rap Spoke Straight to God, rap like rap music. Yeah. Oh. 5 years from today, we talk about it. So it's not too long from now, I hope. It depends on what happens at work.
Other questions?
Way in the back.
Way back, yeah.
This is actually for all three of you. What is it about poetry that really attracts you to the art?
Good question.
Go for it. Okay. All right. About writing poetry, like what attracts me to it? Just trying to make sense out of the world, out of my own experiences, and out of the experiences of others. I'm usually not the type of person that is into, like now we have, our society is sort of infected a little bit by this, you know, selfie fever, right? Taking selfies a lot or things like that. I've never like felt totally comfortable, right? I can think back to being maybe in high school. You know when you take your high school pictures that they say, okay, tilt your head like this and like this, and it feels like really unnatural. So instead of, let's say, doing a photo album or something like that or pictures, for me, if something's memorable, I want to capture it in a poem. So basically to just try to understand life and just to capture whatever I think is important, I'd say.
I agree with what Rita has said. I think for me it is often a way of trying to sort of make sense of a kind of chaos. And I think the form of poetry, I think I gravitate toward that because I also love music, and I really see music as playing a big role in poetry. The sounds of the words take me places sometimes I wouldn't ordinarily go as I try to make sense of the world. So there's that sort of integration of loving the music of the words, sort of bumps and grinds the sounds, but also wanting to try to get my hands around the sort of chaos. I love form also, and especially form that messes it up. And I think I know the wonderful Peter Meinke really influenced my love of form, and mm-hmm. he's such a master mm-hmm. at it. But I find that form often will take you somewhere that you don't necessarily expect to go. So that's a particular kind of poetry that mm-hmm. that I enjoy, that helps me make sense of things that I'm not even sure I would have done. I was asking those questions. I also think that for me, it's a way of connecting with a broader world. I don't know. I think I try to write poems that allow readers to enter in. And I think it doesn't always happen, but when it does, I think I feel a sort of connection that I don't know that I would feel from another art form. Although I would argue there's such great overlap between among the arts, and I think it's so important. Just for me, it's poetry. So
I started out thinking that I was going to write short stories, but then someone told me in school that nothing happened in my stories and that I didn't have any sense of character and plot, which was true. So I realized what really interested, it's true, true, I cried for like 6 days. What really interested me about writing was the specificity of capturing a moment, not necessarily a series of actions, but a moment. Sorry to the former students who have heard me say this over and over again, but having to be that precise in your portrayal of something was really, really appealing to me. The other thing that I liked, that I found in the poets that I fell in love with early on, people like Lowell and in Anne Sexton, was that something about poetry seemed to make it okay to say things that you wouldn't say out loud. And believe it or not, at that point, I was almost painfully shy when I started writing. But somehow having this place where I could put things on the page and somehow be able to share them and feel as if it was okay, I sort of like developed as a person and as a writer. And for some reason, I think poetry lends itself to that more so than prose does. But that was really what drew me to it. That's where I fell in love with it. Yeah.
Are you a poet? What, how would you answer your own question?
I'm not a poet. I'm actually here because the lovely Rita's husband is a friend of my mother, so I'm
not. That's awesome.
Totally
normal.
The difficulty that I find with poetry is I honestly find it less precise than prose, so I have difficulty making the connections that the author would want me to connect. So I find it much easier to, instead of skipping the these and the ands make more sense to me, because when poetry cuts out a lot of transitional words, and I think very step by step by step by step. So poetry jumps around a lot. Mm-hmm. And while it can be very beautiful, and I've found poetry that I really do love, Edgar Allan Poe, for example,
yay,
it's just very difficult for me to find connection with all poetry.
Mm-hmm. That's probably true for most of us. It's hard to find connection with all poetry. Yeah, so that's a very common feeling. Yes, please.
For all three of you, because I write, I suspect I know the answer, at least it's the same for me. Do you have any choice? I write because I have no choice, okay? And I think the thing that first attracted me to poetry was I foolishly thought that there were no rules. But what I've noticed in making the transition from something that you have a natural tendency to write to making specific literary references in your work. Mm-hmm. Is that transition for you smooth and automatic? Do you not have to think about it at all, or is it a conscious effort for you?
Rita?
All right. Let me go back, I think, to somewhere toward the beginning of the question. You said that you write because you have to. You can't, like, not write.
I write
because I have no choice.
I think it probably kept me from
killing somebody, even myself. Oh, yeah. There, some poems that you write, you know you have to write them because when you're writing them, you feel uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. So I have some of those in this book. And even sometimes reading some of those, I might still feel a little bit uncomfortable, or I know that there are certain poems that might make certain audience members or readers feel uncomfortable. But to leave it out would be like unthinkable,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. And what was the second half? It's like, so in terms of that, I have to. What was the second half of
Early on, when I was young, my poetry was always, you know, this out of my heart, I've got this, right?
Mm-hmm.
As I began to have professors who said, okay, read this, I found more literary references and more, if you know what I mean, more capturing. So I wrote more about literary ideas and literary things than about other writers.
Mm-hmm.
And in the beginning, it felt forced, but eventually it was simply, the transition was smooth to write about that, to make those. I found that I was no longer making deliberate references until I read it. And
That makes sense. I know that there's a poem in here that has like a reference to Zeus. The other day I wrote a poem that had a reference to King Arthur and Guinevere. It was like about a poem about relationships and betrayals. Mm-hmm. And maybe initially when I had first started writing poetry, that would have felt forced. But when I was working on this poem, I haven't even typed it up yet, you know, because I do first longhand. And then I, you know, type it in the PC. And then I thought, you know, when I did the rough draft, I thought, yeah, that's the relationship that is like a quintessential example of how things can be great in a marriage or a relationship, right? And then secrets and things start happening. So that felt kind of natural to mention them. But had I done a poem where I mentioned King Arthur and Guinevere, like 15 years ago or something like that, it probably would have felt a little forced. So I totally get what you're saying.
I used to say that I write poetry because I have to. But then I've gone through periods in my life where I haven't written poetry for one reason or another. My heart still kept beating. So it's not that I have to, but it's that I understand that I am a better human being when I'm writing. Like, you can just ask anyone who's close to me, like, Erica, you clearly haven't been writing because you're acting a fool. So it's, for me, it's there is some sort of innate need to do it as a kind of means of a preservation, but it feels sort of natural to me. I think, like you were saying, the connection to music is really important. I'm a musician and was trained from a very early age to play the piano, and there's just something about that beat that moves along in my head. Like, I'm listening to myself talk and I'm waiting to hear the iams. That's just how my brain works. I read the signs on the road and I'm like scanning the lines. So there is something in it that's natural to me. It feels natural now when the literary allusions come into play, but that was not always the case. That was just solely a product, and this is me sort of only kind of sponsoring UT's MFA program, but that didn't happen until I went to graduate school and was forced to read countless books. Like, I was thinking about the idea of food and sustenance, and all of a sudden this morning I think of a part of Leaves of Grass where Whitman is talking about sustenance. I couldn't have done that if I hadn't have been in school for 7 years. But now my brain is able to make those connections. And it's actually, it can get in the way of your work, but it's also, I think, a really fun thing because you actually start to feel like you're part of the conversation, that those authors are no longer sort of living above you, but you actually have something to say to them now. But it took a while for that to feel normal. But I had teachers who were like, please get outside of your own head. Mm-hmm. Nobody cares about what happened on Friday night.
Yeah, and I think all I would add to that is, I think I also can do without writing poetry for periods of time, and certainly have. I also love to write essays. I love the lyric essay. And that's a sort of hybrid genre that many of you are probably familiar with, a sort of cross-section between poetry and prose. I think it's powerful. Actually, you could probably argue that just a good essay does that anyway. And there's a lot of course, fabulous just prose, just fiction writing that also uses the best techniques of poetry. So I think there's so much overlap there, and I enjoy all of those. I wanted to go back, though. You know, I was thinking about some of the references, and I was reminded of the epigraph, Shakespeare, that Erica mentioned. I love epigraphs. I think epigraphs are a wonderful way to weave in references, and I love how they sort of encourage the mind to make a leap, and maybe even approach the poem in front of you slightly differently, kind of from a different level. So that's an example of using a reference that to me feels fairly natural. They can be overdone. I've probably overdone them some, but they can be a lot of fun as well. So, time for just a couple more questions. Yes, back here, please.
This comes from a comment that Erica made, but for all three of you, you said, you talked about changing the secret in the middle of a set scene. What forms do you guys find that are most conducive to including multiple voices? So like, you know, on the flip side, which one's the most fun to include multiple voices?
Gosh, good question.
Well, for me, they're the forms that lend themselves to a narrative. The sestina works for me because it has to be 39 lines, and nobody wants to hear 39 lines out of the same person's head. It helps when you've got some sort of conversation, some sort of conflict, some sort of, you know, the essentials of a narrative going in there. So that's a place for me where it feels really natural. Something like a villanelle, when it's just sort of repeating itself and musing on something, that feels not natural for a villanelle. So I would say things like the sestina, or, you know, good old-fashioned blank verse, the forms that, where the repetition, there isn't any repetition, or the repetition isn't as obvious, because the words aren't rhyming, to me, seem to lend themselves better than that kind of thing. Yeah.
Well, I'm thinking the crown that mm-hmm. you read. I mean, really, any kind of form that gives you a block.
Yeah.
But you can sort of go back and forth with. I think the sonic crown is a great example of how you can kind of pull that off. Having said that, I can't claim to have done too many poems where I have different speakers woven in. That sounds like something I probably need to do more of. And I do often bring dialogue in, but I set it up more as dialogue. So that's a very interesting question.
I have also in my book a crown of sonnets. It's a poem called Jane Eyre, classic cover girl. It's awesome. If you go online and you Google, there's a bunch of like Jane Eyre covers that you'll find online, and some are real and some are like spoofs. So each sonnet, and I write, you know, I probably would go nuts. Honestly, it's not my thing to write per se, and I am a big pentameter. But it does the repetition of the lines, and it stays true to what the essence of a sonnet is, which is you're really honing in with that lens on a very specific moment in time or image. So each one has like a different tone. Each one is like a different book cover, right? Mm-hmm. And each one has a different tone, not per se a character, but almost as if it were. Like a different tone. And I find like what's been said earlier today, that something like that, you do take leaps that you wouldn't normally take with that type of, you know, with that type of form. And I've done a similar thing, not in this book, in other poems that I've written, but actually like with prose blocks, because way back I read one of Sherman Alexie's books, First Indian on the Moon, and he has like these prose poems, right, that do almost a similar thing to a crown of sonnets, where there's that repetition of certain lines, and it's kind of neat because you never know where that's gonna take you exactly.
There was a question way in the back. I didn't want to forget.
Yeah, one more.
I'm really curious. Whenever you write a piece, or you know, you come up with this new piece of work, is there a grace period or a purgatory period that the piece goes through before you decide it's ready for the world and it doesn't go in the trash basket? I mean, is there kind of a process that you use to make sure that you're ready to announce it?
I think for me, it's different for every poem.
Mm-hmm.
When Erica was talking about this long poem she's been working on, I have a long poem that it's been going on for a couple of years. I have no idea, like, when is that one gonna end? I think what's frustrating is sometimes I've had a poem, has this happened, where you feel it's like 95% there, but it needs that extra 5 or 2%. But I think for me, for every poem, it's kind of different. What about you?
My first instinct is put everything in the trash. It's just true. I tell people all the time that the feeling that I'm waiting for when it's ready to go out in the world is moderate satisfaction. I am moderately satisfied with this poem because I'm never going to be like, oh yeah, it's time. But
I'm able to push myself, because I would just hold on to things for years and just try to crack at it and make it as perfect as it could be. But you can't do that. Like, that's not healthy. So I rely on the friends that I have who are my readers to tell me that it's time. It's easy to do with other people's work. You're like, yeah, Kara, I recognize this is amazing. It's time to go out. But I myself have a hard time making that decision about my own work. So I have sort of set myself up with friends who can help make it for me. But I'm just not somebody who comes to that moment where it's like, yes, it's time for this to be in print. I would, at the end of the first book I wrote, there's a really long poem, and it was 7 years before I let it see the light of day. And that's too long. That's quite problematic. I think if you're someone like me, it is necessary to, if what you're working towards is sharing your work with an audience, it is necessary to rely on trusted readers to help you make the decision that it's just time to let something go. Time to let it go to the trash, or time to let it go to other people if you're having a hard time making those decisions on your own, like I do.
Yeah, I think writing groups can be, really a terrific way of getting feedback and letting you know if your work's kind of headed in the right direction, and if it's time maybe to let something go. Although I am a relentless reviser, I suspect you all are as well, and I don't really have a problem. I mean, I even revise things after they've been published, which is maybe a little bit
insane. I revise things at the mic. Well, like, there were things that weren't written down that I said that aren't there, so, yeah.
Is a fabulous visual artist. Some of you, I'm sure, have seen her terrific murals all over the city. How about you, Carrie?
Well,
for you, with your
artwork.
One
of the reasons why I asked is because that is a huge thing that I deal with. Is, I make something and I think, oh my God, is this ready? And I still am working on a process to figure out when I'm ready for it to go out in the world. And I was just curious how you deal with that.
There are people who think that it comes like in one fell swoop, and how it looks on the page, like it came like manna from the gods, and the poem, how it looks like that, but you don't know. It's usually that's not the case. That may happen occasionally, but at least for me, it's like few and far between. I don't know about you guys. Yeah,
it's important for me to acknowledge the fact that I feel my poems sort of work in my life the same way that my relationships with people do. Like, sometimes I like you, sometimes I don't. Some days it's great to talk to you, and some days I really don't ever want to see your face again. And my relationship changes with the poems that I write. So one day I might be like, oh yeah, I'm sending this to New Yorker. And then it's like the next day, that was the dumbest thing that you ever did. You have to call the New Yorker and tell them not to look at it. But I think that's a natural thing in terms of the relationship that you have with your work. So I had to stop myself from thinking of a poem as being ready, because I didn't know what that meant. Like, what is it ready for? So again, I'm just looking for someone else to, like in a writing group, to give me some idea of where they think it's at. And then if I just get to a point where I'm like, okay, I feel like I've done everything that I can do, that it's time to put it out in the world. But I'm always going to think later that there's more that I could do.
But then there's another thing that happens. Then it's, is the MS ready in general? Like, is your manuscript ready in general? And in terms of thinking of, like, a full book of poetry, in terms of thinking of a collection, sometimes for me what has spurred me to revise more, there are times I have thought something's done. And then your book makes the rounds. And for me, my book being rejected a lot made me revise a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It pushed me.
I guess that's all we have time for. Please join me in thanking Erica.